It's pretty magical for us. It was our largest show.
It was amazing. Just the number of people that turned up.
It marked the end of a period of our career.
See anything until I walked up on stage and I just saw just a sea of people. That was pretty insane.
It's times like that that stuff really comes together and you kind of actually, you know, it all makes it worth it. You kind of realise, oh, I am in a band and these people are here to see it, and you know, it was really cool. And obviously our lot are particularly special because they're kind of, they're all well up for kind of getting dressed up and getting into the whole feel of the event.
Some of them like turn up like the day before we're actually playing there, just queuing outside.
Yeah, we got in for 7. It was 7 when we got it?
About that, yeah. A lot of fans do travel early.
I'm not from London. I've come on a 6-hour bus journey to get here today.
This is my 38th show so far in, well, just under 2 years. And the amount of faces that I've seen in today already, and more coming tonight, and I've met them all from all the different gigs around the country, and to have everyone united in one place, this is what makes this gig most special. I mean, there's a girl that's come from America for this
gig. Just to see this gig.
Well, I'm CJ, and I came to this from Florida because I really, really love Fearless Vampire Killers. So my all-time favorite band. Their music and everything they stand for, and the fact that just they're just such nice, genuine people, it just really spoke to me. I might not be your thing, but if you're looking for a freak,
to light an effigy outside your gates, well. Our fans, they make me happy. When I need reassurance, they provide it. When the album came out, we got a really bad review. That was the first review for a magazine called Roxanne, and it really kind of shocked us. Fans will rise up against it and say, you know, this is rubbish, and that heartens me.
We actually just recently kind of built our own social network, just sort of keep in touch with our own dedicated fans.
They've brought such a family together with the fans. We all look out for each other. I mean, I'm always at most of the gigs, so I'll always look after anybody that's come.
It's a unique experience having the whole online social network where you can talk to people and then you can meet them at gigs.
It's kind of why we've made things like the Obsidian Bond, our social network. It gives people that really want it, like that bit more access to kind of us and kind of our world.
A lot of artwork, whether it be someone sort of made a sort of painting or a little model of us or something, that's always sort of memorable, and we keep them all and we put them up on our, we've got a studio back in Beccles and we stick it all on our wall there, so when we're practicing we see it all.
Why wouldn't you treat fans of your band with the same respect that you would treat any kind of friend? Because they're, you know, they're allowing us, they're enabling us to do this, like, amazing thing, enabling us to kind of live our dream, essentially. So, you know, we've got the utmost respect for those people, and I think we owe it to them to show our gratitude.
Anyway, we're going to move straight from the new, right back to the old. The song's about a boy who got a bit of shit, so, he's dealt with it in the only way that he could, by fucking shit up. It's called Bite Down on My Winchester.
I try and speak to everyone. I think, I don't know whether it's like my size or what, but I think people get intimidated to come and talk to me. But yeah, I'm happy to speak to anyone.
I love the fact that we're inspiring people to do things.
So far I've listened to Phyllis Rambakers for must have been about 4 or 5 years now. They're just a massive part of my life, inspired me in so many ways. Like Drew's inspired me to play bass guitar, and Lawrence has given me more confidence.
They're theatrical, bizarre, eccentric.
Worryingly weird.
One word I'd just probably just have to say epic. Just completely epic.
We're abnormal, certainly at the moment in England. I mean, England obviously, and Britain has a great history of theatrical bands, like one of our favourites being Queen and David Bowie and the Kinks. But at the moment, there's not many.
Like, it's a boys' club as well. Like, no one wants us to be a part of it. We've never supported an English band. Never. They don't want anything to do with us.
In the mainstream, it's not widely accepted, and you take a lot of flack for, you know, doing the kind of thing that we do. For us, I think it's a double-edged sword. We wouldn't dress like this if we didn't want to.
This is what makes me feel comfortable. Some of my favourite musicians don't have an image, but I just think that English bands have taken that too far. I think everyone in England is trying to be Bruce Springsteen, and there's only one Bruce Springsteen. Like, no one, not everyone can be blue collar, not everyone can speak from, you know, what they think is the heart and what is really just the regurgitation of 20 years of English indie bands and, you know, taking elements of sort of soft rock American bands.
I think the first impression people have of you is very image-based. And I think it's a shame to just ignore it.
No one really wants to say it, but image is massively important in everything.
Even bands that say they don't have an image, they've even sat down and kind of, they decide which t-shirt they're gonna wear.
I always think about it like tuning a car. So why would you have this amazing car and you'd spend all this money tuning the engine, making sure it runs properly and it sounds great and it drives really fast, and then just neglect to do the paint job?
You know, we get a lot of stick for putting on makeup and dressing up.
Yeah, I think someone said once that I looked like I couldn't decide whether I wanted to be a girl or a boy.
Because even though we are like a band with an image, obviously we want the music to be front and centre. We just, yeah, it's a difficult conundrum because we want to be a band that presents something other than an image.
An image is never the kind of central thing to any one band, and it's not the central thing to our band, it's just a natural thing.
I just wish people would just judge us on our music rather than what we look like.
On our first album, we were slightly more ragtag, kind of all wearing different kind of bits and a lot more makeup. But now we're kind of, I don't know, we're all kind of dressing a little bit more in sync. We're all in black suits.
I mean, look at me. I mean, like, if I wanted to be in a successful band that looked cool, I wouldn't dress like this and I wouldn't look like this, because I'm just going to get ridiculed for it.
It's not an entirely conscious thing, like, to try and water down what we had before, but more an indication of where we are at the moment. With our sound, we progress our image, and vice versa.
People tend to not like it, but at least you do. We are remembered. as that band, even if it is that gay band that wear makeup, you know.
In a sense, we have way more to prove because we've got to show that we are like as good as we think we are, because people are already gunning for us not to be very good. And I can see why, because some bands do think with Hairspray first and, you know, Guyliner first, but we've always been music first. The trend in England is to kind of be restrained to be credible, which is not always a calculated thing, but there's this kind of cynicism inbuilt in our kind of English or British society, really, so that if you're being too flamboyant or you're being too, I don't know, erring on the ridiculous or the surreal or the comedic, you don't have integrity. That's certainly something we've come across with knee-jerk criticisms of us, is that if you're not trying to look like just a normal guy, or you're not trying to sing general world problems, you're not speaking truth, you're not being real.
I think American music is a lot more sincere. I think English bands, they're pessimistic. They don't ever think that they should do anything. Like, they never have any goals, English bands. Like, they haven't for years and years. I think my music, or our music, definitely, has no boundaries. I think that the music lets itself free, and I think that's been our mistake. And I think English music is pessimistic in the sense that it's scared to go far, especially English rock music. I think if the band can keep going, then it will be big. But I'm not the best person to ask, really.
I can imagine some people getting frustrated because it takes a long time and people might just want to get there fast. You know, they want to get to Wembley Stadium now or whatever, you know, or an arena, whatever their goal is. I'm quite easily pleased as long as people still don't get bored of us and new people want to listen to us and we kind of, I can see us progressing, like, I'll be happy.
I think Europe's definitely the next step for us. We've wanted to get out there for ages, but never really had an opportunity.
The album's going to get a proper physical release in Europe at the end of March, I believe. And we're going to be touring out there around that time as well. So I guess Europe next, and then all the others, Japan, Australia. We're quite US-centric musically, like we're akin to a lot of bands over there.
Like you see a lot more kind of theatrical bands in America, or like, and even bands that don't look theatrical are much more theatrical, they're much more, again, really cliche to say, but there's a bit more American savvy, there's a bit more, in general, confidence and bravado.
Our first sort of compliments we got over there were very music-based. They're about Keir being able to sing well, or Drew being able to play your bass particularly well.
We did this one gig in Denver and I got off stage and someone complimented me on my amazing control of my falsetto. And I got off and I was like, did you just say that? Did you actually just say that? Wow, thank you very much. That's really nice. But I'm used to people just saying I have nice hair. So that's a new one, thank you.
I think American bands have a bit more freedom to be creative because it's a larger market, and they can you can tour a lot in America and just keep touring America, whereas English bands, it's hard for them to break out of just England. It's a big musical market, but there's not as much opportunity, kind of just volume of people-wise.
If we play our cards right, then that's where we'll end up. I don't think there's not much England has to offer us, really, because, like, despite our fans, who, you know, mean everything to us and kept us going, like, that's no word of a lie, like, they've... Without our fans, we wouldn't have survived. But there's just not enough of them for us to continue to exist. Do you know what I mean? Like, I don't know if that will expand in England. I don't think there's space. I don't think there's enough people here for us to keep going as a band. I think we do need to find new horizons.
But I guess I'd like to our band to have had some kind of impact on the world, whatever it might be. it doesn't necessarily have to be kind of like we changed it, but like we changed it for at least some people. That would definitely be nice. Like, just having some kind of legacy I'd like to leave, basically, rather than just being another small blotch on the toilet paper of the musical world.
I guess the album kind of came about with our kind of relationship with Will Francis, or Will Control. We supported him and Aiden, and that was our kind of first tour. Like, our first chart playing like reasonable sized venues, and then he took us out on our first proper UK tour a couple of years ago now.
Although we were friends with Will, I'd never been that comfortable around him. I've always been quite intimidated by him because I was a fan of his growing up, and he's quite an intimidating person. If you don't know him to talk to, he's quite scary, but he's not really. We're very close to Will now.
We had a couple of weeks to get write the songs and a couple of weeks to rehearse the songs, then we were going to America, so it was all very tight and stressful. We had 4 weeks there and we had 16 quite ambitious tracks to do.
I had to track and have 16 songs in 2 days. It was like this guy had like built the studio inside a mountain, which was insane. So you're underground, so there's really cool sound in there. And I think like Nirvana recorded there and Foo Fighters.
We're trying to aim for a kind of Queen, ambitious, bizarre opus. And yeah, it got very stressful towards the end. With unbreakable hearts, we make our stand by, yeah. With unbreakable hearts, we take back what we've lost. With unbreakable hearts, we fight and surrender redemption. At the ends of the earth, we cry.
I think the main thing is our bond as people. We grew up together.
I've known them for, you know, 20 odd years. They're just like brothers, and the same with Luke. Even though I've only known him a few years, he was literally like, when we needed to find another drummer, we met him and knew he was, you know, he was someone who was just like us.
I think the reason why they got me in the band is because they knew that I was one of them.
We lived together in a tiny little flat on top of each other, literally.
We're country lads, most of us, and you know, we grew up simple beginnings, and we have like, you know, we come from nice families, we grew up around nice people, we grew up around each other, we're very comfortable with each other. I just think that kind of aspect of it comes naturally, and we're not very good at putting on a facade, I don't think, like, which is kind of ironic considering our image and things, but as people, I just think we're all quite honest.
We've been doing this since we were 15 years old, and 25 now, so that's 10 years.
We rely on each other. Look, I don't think we'll survive without each other.
We're our own little world, just the five of us.
There isn't a weak link. They're all brilliant, and I would trust my life with them.
This second album is really taking us on a journey. It's been a hard journey, and I think this is kind of the, you know, it's like when you eat chocolate, you eat chocolate and you feel brilliant. Like, before you eat the chocolate, you're miserable. And then you eat the chocolate and you feel great. But then everything comes down. I think you need to avoid chocolate altogether and start eating complex carbohydrates. I think that's what we need to do.